My name is Andre Koen, and I wanted to welcome you to Beyond the Rhetoric 2. Oftentimes, there are lots of ways in which we talk about police, that we make inferences or references to the actions that they make. But often, we don't get an opportunity to actually listen to what police have to say. And so in this particular episode of Beyond the Rhetoric, we'll be sitting down with police officers from the 7-county metro area to really talk about their concepts of community policing. What we recognize is that implicit bias, community policing, and this blue line have a very profound impact on the community, but often we don't understand what this means for officers and policing itself. And so, in this episode, we invite you to think critically, to listen intently, and possibly even change your own behavior as we go beyond the rhetoric. Over the recent months, we've had a lot of conversations about law enforcement. And typically in those conversations, law enforcement has not been a part of it. So tonight, we've brought together very vastly different communities and approaches to community policing to have a conversation. So if you wouldn't mind, if Chief Anderson, if we can start with you, and we'll do kind of a round table. Can you tell us a little bit about the communities that you serve and the role you play in your law enforcement organization?
Sure. First of all, thank you for having me, and thank you for providing this forum. I think you're spot on when you say a lot of talking has been done, mostly at us and not with us. So thank you for that. I'm the chief of police in the city of St. Cloud, which is 50 miles west of downtown Minneapolis. We have the second or third largest university in the state in that city. St. Cloud is also unique in that it sits in three counties and two judicial districts. And those are sometimes vastly different from one another. My role, first and foremost, is public safety. And that's a very broad area to cover, but we have a great many strategies that we employ to that end. The normal population is 70,000, but when school's in, add another 20 with staff and students at the university, and our daily commuter traffic puts us over 100,000 people a day in our city. So there's lots of opportunities for us to engage the people that come to St. Cloud, whether they live there, whether they come there to work, or whether they matriculate to the university.
All right, great. Thank you. Chief Stewart.
I would echo what the chief said. Thank you for having us. This is a unique opportunity. We appreciate it very much. My name is James Stewart, and I have the distinct privilege of serving as the elected sheriff of Anoka County. Anoka County, for those unfamiliar with it, we're kind of nestled on the north side of the Twin Cities. Our southern border is basically North Minneapolis and Columbia Heights. We go north up into Isanti, east into Forest Lake, and west over to Elk River. So within that pocket, we have about 350,000 people, diversely different pockets within the communities. And within our office, we have six different divisions that provide services to all of Anoka County, all 21 communities of Anoka County, and numerous specialty areas as well within each of those divisions. And we work very closely in Anoka County with all of our partners in law enforcement as well as on the fire side. We have a very unique public safety partnership throughout Anoka County where we all strive for the same purpose, and that's serving our citizens to the best of our ability.
Great. Thank you.
Chief Andre, I'll echo what's already been said here. Thanks for having us here. It's an important step in making sure that we're having a dialogue that's two ways and productive, and making sure that our public knows that law enforcement stands with them on so many of these issues. My name is Scott Nadeau, and I am the chief of police in the city of Columbia Heights. I've been there for 8 years. Columbia Heights is an amazing city of about 20,000 people. It's one of the most diverse communities in Minnesota. About 80% of our kids are children of color. And it's also one of the least affluent cities in Minnesota. again, going back to our school statistics, about 75% of our kids are on free and reduced lunch. So it's a city that's always embraced diversity. It's a city that has always welcomed people from other cultures and other areas of the world, whether that was 100 years ago and there was Polish immigrants, or if it's more recently and we have Hispanic immigrants and Somali immigrants, and people from literally all over the world that come to our community.
Great. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Deputy Chief Ivino.
Yeah, thank you very much. Yes, and again, thanks. An important conversation, and very pleased to be here and to be a part of the conversation. My name is Paul Ivino. I'm the Deputy Chief of Major Crimes at the St. Paul Police Department. This is our backyard to be here, so it's really our honor to be a part of the conversation. The City of St. Paul is approximately 300,000 people. It's approximately 620 sworn officers, about 200 sworn staff, or excuse me, civilian staff. We have an extremely diverse community on a lot of different levels. We have, of course, the historic Rondo community, the heart of the African American community. We have the West Side and the East Side now coming up right behind the West Side with a very large Latino population. Our most recent immigrant populations, I would say, are the Karen and Karini from Burma and Southeast Asia, and East Africa with the Oromo and Somali population. So last I heard, I think we speak about 100 different languages in St. Paul Public Schools, and we have about 42,000 students in our public school system. So we're large, we're busy, and we're very committed to the community. So I feel really good about being here today and being a part of this discussion. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. And Chief Snell.
Paul Snell, Maplewood Police Department. I'm honored to be here. Maplewood is a community of about 40,000 people, a first ring suburb, a community that is really undergoing significant redevelopment. It's as a first ring suburb and one of the older suburbs around St. Paul, share 11 miles of border with St. Paul. It's unique. It's home to 3M as kind of a major corporate site within the community. But then it has an incredible mix of different populations, housing. The demographics are changing dramatically because of our strange geography, the way the city's kind of laid out. We, pass through many of the major freeways in the community. Borders 494, 694, 35E, and 36 all kind of run through. So it's been a busy community with a lot of change going on, as I think most of the communities, large and small, across Minnesota.
Yeah, yeah. As I hear you talk about all of your communities, I've traveled through, lived in, or interacted with all of the communities that you're coming from, and I think the promise that is Minnesota is affecting all of us, and the growth in the refugees and the immigrants and the welcoming nature of Minnesota, I think, is a contributing factor to that. So in your individual communities, how are you adapting, how are you engaging those changing demographics, be it the refugees or migrant communities, or even the flow in or out of affluent individuals? How do you manage that, those changing demographics in your municipality?
Well, I'll speak first for the St. Paul Police Department. It's been a bit of an easy response in the sense that we recently went through a change of guard, and Chief Todd Axtell is now the chief of police, who had three very easy priorities when he took over as the chief of police, and he picked his leadership team. But one of the things he focused on was community engagement at epic levels. And I can tell you that in his first 100 days, he was very strategic in making sure that he was true to his word, and he stood up in a very short period of time, which falls under my division in St. Paul, community engagement unit. And the community engagement unit is roughly about eight officers of varying ranks, run by a senior commander in the district right now. We're recently sifting through 190 interviews. We have a few positions available for community engagement specialists. And these are civilians in the community and from the diverse communities across St. Paul that really, I think, are going to help us understand the community better. And it's going to give us an opportunity to hear directly from people inside of the community about what some of the concerns are, about some of the things that are going well. And in turn, it's going to allow us a better vehicle when we're trying to get information back out to the community to be able to do that in a more efficient manner. So it's one of the things that we're looking forward to, amongst many other things. I certainly want to give my colleagues a chance to respond to that as well. But that I would highlight as one of the things that we've just launched. We're very excited about where that might go and how that's going to represent our very diverse community.
I can tell you, for the city of St. Cloud, it begins and ends at the top, at City Hall. It starts with our mayor, and it starts with our other elected officials. And I can also tell you, and it's something I'm very proud of, is the citizens there understand what that means, right? We can engage all day long, but my dad was an engineer and taught me at a very early age you build a bridge from both sides, right? You can't start in the middle. And so the vast majority of the citizens in St. Cloud understand exactly what that means. And so, you know, we're proud to put forward any number of strategies that our folks can come up with. And I tell the people that work with and for me, if you have an idea, let's hear it, right? Information is power. It does us no good if you keep it to yourself. And the same goes for our community. So for us, it's a matter of course. We just recently had our 11th annual conversation on race. As is the case with every city, our demographics are changing. We have a large East African population, but it doesn't stop there, right? We've got a fairly decent size Latino population and an Asian population. And so one of the things that is working well for us is that we don't create those silos, right? We mean it when we say community. I don't like the hyphenated part, because people often ask me questions, well, how's your Somali community doing? And I look at them like they're speaking Russian and French. We have one community, right? All are welcome. And so for us, that being our foundation has been very, very helpful. And again, the citizens there understand that that train's already left the station, and so they understand that we're all responsible for what our communities look like, and that's not going to change, right? The demographics will continue to change, and I appreciate that they've embraced that, and I'll talk later about some of the different strategies that we use, but that's a huge part that helps us be successful engaging our folks, and it's something that we do every single day, right? We try and stay proactive with that.
Andre, I can say that, first of all, it's really a privilege to be with some of these leaders and to be able to have this conversation, because there's so many great things that are happening in Minnesota. I think that we're oftentimes looked to as a model in the nation, but community policing really is supposed to be law enforcement co-producing response to crime and violence and disorder with the community. So you have to be actively engaged with the community, so you're talking about community dialogues. We have a multicultural advisory committee, people that assemble every month and give us the perspectives of our small community and our Hispanic community. We have people that have lived in Columbia Heights for 50 years that are Caucasian that are part of this, because we want everyone to come to those conversations and let us know how we can do a better job of partnering. So much of it really is understanding your diverse communities. And for us, we've been very fortunate in that we've been able to diversify our workforce, so that when we go into some of our neighborhoods and we have, an Ethiopian officer and a couple of Somali officers, we can go into these neighborhoods and build relationships by going door to door and talking to people in a language that they understand. And by having staff members that understand some of these cultural norms, that can then not only interact with the public, but also help us to understand what some of these norms are or how we can better interact. I really think that Minnesota's been doing a great job of making sure that we're going to all these different communities, we're building those relationships, so that when there is questions, we're able to have a relationship in place where we can answer those questions without it being some sort of a crisis.
So I think for us, I think we've, one of the things that has been really key for us citywide, and I think as Blair talked about, the kind of this whole notion of from the top down, and the council kind of established racial equity as kind of a major focus. And And one of the things that's been key to that has really been doing measurement. And I think one of the things that we've really tried to focus on is look, what are some of the outcomes that we've had as a community, and what are the ways in which what are the implications of the work that we do on different communities? And you know, sometimes to be frank, that those numbers don't look all that good. And I think these are some of the realities that we face. Really across Minnesota, really, and across the country, we know that some of these disparities and disproportionality exist, and yet at the same time, the way we're going to ultimately address that is, I think, has been talked about by everyone here, is through relationship building. We are still in a position where we have to respond, we have to hold people accountable, but we have to address some of the core and underlying issues that really are grounded in strong relationships and having community involved in policing efforts.
Chief Stewart.
I would agree with everything that's been said, and I think it really, you know, when it comes down to the philosophy of community policing, how do we expand partnerships? How do we improve collaboration and cooperation? And for us, a big part of that has been those dialogues and those interactions. And so getting out into the community, whether it's in the schools, whether it's in a coffee shop, whether it's in community forums, all these different things and all the different forms that it can take on. But it really comes down to having those dialogues and helping the community to understand who we are, what we're about, and what we're about is serving the community. And as long as the community understands that, then that first block has been set and the foundation. And the foundation only gets stronger as we continue to set more blocks by having more and more meetings.
So I hear lots of really good stuff that police officers are doing. You have programs, you have some things in place. The community has some concerns though, right? So given the nature of what you're doing and how you're engaging with the community, one of the concerns is, you know, we did research as we were gathering this circle, was around this idea of the blue line, right? And so is that blue line, and is it an urban legend? Is it a real thing? Like, can you speak a little bit about this idea of the blue line?
Well, I just met with a bunch of our staff as we hire people, and I've met with all of our folks. We have what we call the vision talk, to talk about who we are, where we're going, and who we are as an organization, and our vision moving forward. And a part of that is to discuss this concept of the thin blue line. In that presentation, I make it clear to them that there is a thin blue line. But I think the interpretation of what that means is where it gets muddy. Because for us, I see that as individuals who are willing to go out and sacrifice on their own behalf in order to serve others. And the thin blue line is actually just a symbolic line in between normalcy on one side and chaos on the other. And who's willing to walk that line in order to maintain normalcy and peace for our communities, and who's willing to walk that line in order to rapidly restore normalcy if something should erupt or something goes sour or something goes south. But it, to me, the line just represents individuals who are willing to protect and serve others. There's no, I shouldn't say, within my interpretation of it, there's not a negative aspect to it.
With that said, I agree with the sheriff. I think it is one of those situations. At the same time, I think, I'm guessing what people are talking about is some of the concerns that have been raised about the culture, police culture, right? This is one of the, I don't think that from a leadership standpoint there's anybody who isn't concerned. I think your message around the vision stuff of what is it that we want to be, what are we about, really is the crux of that. And yet, you know, I think when you look at culture and where culture comes from, and we see the issues around distrust that exists within and across, especially communities of color and law enforcement and on the whole, I think you can begin to see and develop some understanding. While I think this is exactly what we're trying to break down through these relationships, you know, for sometimes the officers, we saw this summer, I think, some pretty significant events locally and really across the nation. These events had significant meaning for both the community and for law enforcement, right? There was people who suffered particular harm as a result of these incidents. And I think what's happened is that in many cases, the culture is, like any culture, is we protect kind of what's ours, what what's us, what makes us unsafe. And so in many respects, I think what's happening is this kind of sense of separation that is a natural response to really tough things is exactly what I think from a leadership standpoint, we're all calling our officers to do is to say this is the time. And it's really tough to lean in and do all these things that are really important in the name of good policing and building stronger communities.
And here's what else. You know, we have to talk about historically, of course. That meant some pretty harsh things, right? Of course, historically, in some places, holding a thin blue line meant, you know, closing the ranks, right? And looking out for our own first, no matter what. That's part of the history, right? Just like all of the sordid history America has to offer, that's another part of it. But I couldn't agree more with Sheriff Stewart and Chief Snell. Nowadays, and particularly when we see things that are happening that causes the community concern, I'm going to say it because I've said it before, a lot of times it's a leadership issue. And I'll give you an example. If you read the DOJ report on Ferguson, the incident with the officer Michael Brown was the flashpoint. That had been boiling for a decade. Why? Because the municipal court was under the direct control and supervision of the chief of police, and they were using their police department to generate revenue. That's not our role. And so on whose backs was that money coming from? The people who could least afford it. And that report brought tears to my eyes because that's a perfect example of very poor leadership from the mayor all the way down. At some point, you have to have a line that you draw in the sand yourself and say, yeah, we're not doing that.
Yeah.
And so if that's going to upset the people who've appointed or elected us, then it's time to step aside because you cannot completely compromise your own integrity or that of your department, right? It is a unique fraternity. Everybody can't do this,
right?
And there's a reason why. And so for me, I'll finish with this part on the thin blue line. The other thing it means to me is, we got your back. You call, we come. Period. Doesn't matter your zip code, your income, your education level. When you call us for help, we're coming, right? Whether you are a civilian in our community or whether you're wearing a uniform, it doesn't have to have the same patch as mine, right? And there's no better feeling when you're out there with a bad actor and you hear your brothers and sisters on the quick because you know you're going to get some help. And that's the feeling I hope the people that we serve have when they call us or when they hear us coming, that they can exhale and breathe easy and know we're going to make it right, not make it worse.
Yeah.
You know?
Andre, when you talk about, is the blue line a myth, I can't state any more eloquently what's already been said here. But, I think a lot of people are talking about the blue line of silence, right? This thought that, you know, law enforcement will cover up the misdeeds of other law enforcement officers, that they won't come forward, that we separate ourselves and that we stand apart. And I think that every police officer in the state of Minnesota has had, in the last 20 years, a lot of ethics training, a lot of, university training, to the point where most of the officers we're hiring are four-year degree graduates. They understand corruption on a level that really they didn't probably 40 or 50 years ago, or that, they wouldn't acknowledge. When we look at the blue line of silence, I would say that look at the number of agencies, to include some represented here, that have pushed into body cameras, because we want our communities to know that you can trust what the police officers say. We're using these body cameras to record important information about these calls for service, which are collecting evidence, protecting everyone involved, including that police officer. You look at the number of community dialogues and forums. You look at, the role that our agencies are having now in being in the community. Last year, our police department of only 27 officers had 6,000 hours of positive community contacts out there where we're working with youth. We're working with faith communities to include churches and mosques, and we're working with neighborhood groups, and we're working with all of the business groups, every group that we potentially can, so that we can make sure that these relationships are based on fact and not perception. Because I think that the thin blue line of silence is certainly something, like Chief Anderson said, that is set in the history of not only our country, but our profession. And it's something that I think that we're working very, very hard to communicate to the public, that type of misbehavior, that type of corruption, that a police officer would do something immoral, illegal, or unethical, just won't be tolerated in today's society.
I think a big part of that, sorry to jump in, but I couldn't agree more, and that made me think of it. A part of that vision talk I made reference to is redefining who we are as an organization, as an entity, as a profession. And I think we're all making strides in that direction. We all embrace that, and we want to carry that flag forward. But the other side of that is, to the chief's point, we've arrested more than our share of law enforcement officers. If they cross the line, I don't think anyone has a obligation of holding law enforcement more accountable than law enforcement. I tell all of our people, it is your job to understand that you should be held to a higher standard than the average, Joe the plumber down the street or anybody else, because you've been granted an extreme privilege by the citizens. Mm-hmm. And understand your role. You will be held to a higher standard as such. And I'm not happy to say it, but I'm proud to say we've had our share of, or maybe more than our share of, law enforcement arrests. Because if whether it's domestic assault or DWI or anything in between, if somebody crosses the line, they'll be held to the exact same standard as anybody else we encounter.
Yeah. Nobody hates a bad cop more than a good one.
Well said.
Yeah. We were tested very early on in our new administration with a pretty significant event that was made public and covered in the news regarding an individual that received a dog bite and a use of force that didn't appear appropriate with the circumstances. And it was really the first test for this administration to really get out ahead of that and to call balls and strikes. And that's what we try to do every day. And we have a civilian police internal affairs review commission. And all of our internal affairs complaints go by that commission. And that commission makes a recommendation to the chief of the police. And in this case, the chief of police departed from that and ascended upwardly in the severity of that discipline based on the behavior and the way those officers responded in that situation. And I think that's an example of what we're talking around this table, about accountability, about transparency, about being more accountable and being more transparent and calling balls and strike and holding people accountable when they need to be held accountable. We're engaged in a lot of conversation. I know every chief around this table is. And training about how do we better train our officers? How do we train for better outcomes, to better communicate and work with the community? How do we better train our officers to disengage from situations? How do we better help officers, pull away from a situation to say, hey Paul, I got this one. Let me grab this. And we want better outcomes for our community. We want better outcomes for our peers that we work with. But at the same time, I think it's been stated here, and it can't be overstated, there's no officer that's willing to check their career or who they are for a bad actor. And that's not what anyone around this table is willing to accept from their administrator or their department or for themselves. So we've got some work to do, but we're heading in the right direction.
And here, I think this is noteworthy as well, and if you were going to cover this later, forgive me. What I haven't heard enough with all the conversation that has been directed at us is the examination of some of the root causes that bring people into contact with us. So let's call it like it is, right? And this may upset some people in some communities, but I believe that it's true. The people that we come into contact with, for whatever reason, oftentimes, most often than not, have way more control over the outcome than the average citizen might think. And what do I mean by that? I've got a mantra: comply now, complain later. Right now, we've seen some high-profile incidents and some outliers, if you will, across the nation and even here in our own backyard. But, you know, with the tens of millions of police contacts we have nationwide, every single year, think about how many of those in the right way, right? They end positively. We're able to de-escalate and make the situation better rather than worse. And I'm not an apologist for some of the things that we have seen. So let me be clear about that. But you know, one of the things we do again in St. Cloud is we try and take a comprehensive approach to, you know, what, why are we coming into contact with these people? And some of the answers are obvious, right? You know, lack of education, poverty. There's just some people out there that don't play well with others, right? And they're just not going to, they're not going to be able to function within the parameters of what we think is a civil society. But why? I always ask why. No matter what the answer is, I want to know why. And then we try and address some of those things to perhaps have a better outcome as opposed to a temporary fix. Maybe something more permanent can come of that situation in terms of resolution, right? So we don't, we all know, we've all worked the street, right? The same stuff over and over again, oftentimes the same people. And a longer term fix to me by examining the core of the root causes it's something that traditionally we probably didn't do as well as we do now, but we've evolved to that place. And lastly, we're asking human beings, right, who volunteer to do this to do very extraordinary things now. You know, there was a time when a police officer was a keeper of the peace. Well, mm-hmm. Now you're a social worker, you're a family counselor,
mental health worker,
all of those things. All day, every day, and the general public doesn't see. That's not sexy enough for the news. That's not salacious enough.
Right.
So those day-to-day interactions where really great police work is being done isn't newsworthy, and that's a shame.
So do you think across the board, are you seeing more people in need, in crisis, or is there kind of a ratcheting up of the I guess I'm not sure what my question is, but it seems that we're seeing more and more contacts with the police that that are those salacious things, those things that drive fury or increase passion in the general public against folks that they would probably call when in need anyway, right? So I'm going to fight the police, but yet I'm going to call them if I need them. So why do you think we're having these clashes with our protectors as well as folks that we feel we need to push against?
Andre, I think a lot of it comes down to the title of this show, Rhetoric, Propaganda, the skewed perspectives that are being put out there. I was not too many months ago had a variety of our lawmakers reach out and say, you know, all these things are erupting all over, we want you to know, we support you, we appreciate you, and if there's anything we can do, and I said, I'm glad I have you on the phone. You know what you can do? Present the facts. Talk about statistics. Talk about reality. Get beyond the rhetoric, beyond the propaganda, and evaluate it. I saw not too long ago 385 million contacts with civilians across the nation's law enforcement every year. And we look at the roughly 900 or so lives that are lost to at the hands of law enforcement, with a small fraction of those being quote-unquote unarmed individuals. When we start getting into it, the numbers are very, very small. Now, any inappropriate loss of life is tragic, and any loss of life is tragic, even if it is justified. But I think if we keep it in perspective, most of us have a better chance of winning the lottery or being attacked by a shark than we would of having a negative contact with law enforcement, especially if you apply the chief's principles of comply. Comply now, complain later. We've yet to see anyone, I shouldn't say that, in very, very rare cases, are there negative things that happen out there? Are cops who have big shiny badges that they abuse? Absolutely, and nobody wants them dealt with more than the rest of the law enforcement community because they create this division, they make us look bad. But across the board, I think you'll find, and it's been at least my experience, and I know it would be the sentiment of most law enforcement across our country, all of those that I've met, raise their right hand, put on that shield, and swear that oath to protect and serve, because they do it out of a sense of purpose and a sense of pride in serving the citizens that we're here for. And so somewhere along the line, that framework got lost, and there's a message that isn't being conveyed properly, probably by us, with that building that community foundation. I think we're working on it now. We're trying to close the gap. Unfortunately, that gap has been built there, sometimes by the media, sometimes by leaders who would find it easier to speak from the emotion on their cuff than to speak to the facts. Mm-hmm. And so going back to those phone calls I was getting, I said, just present the facts. If more people in our communities knew the truth and the reality and the fact that we are here for our citizens, and that's the only reason we're here. You know, it ties one of the things I tell our staff too. If our mission statement is to protect and serve the community in a manner that preserves the public trust, because the moment we lose the public trust, there's no reason for us to be here. And so that's what we're seeing across our nation, and that's why we have some groups that would rather divide communities further than to try and build relationships, get beyond the rhetoric, and deal with how do we build those bridges, how do we get back together working together. And so thank you again for doing this show and helping get the message out.
Yeah.
Well, just I think one of the things, I think there is that separation between those incidents that are those super high profile of salacious stuff, and I agree that, you know, we really need to kind of whittle down and look at the facts and look at the true incidents of use of force in general. Inappropriate use of force specifically, I think, is the biggest concern. That said, however, I think there's no doubt that when we look at some of the, there's disparate outcomes that have been achieved on the smaller stuff, right? We still see significant differences in many communities around overrepresentation of youth of color, for instance, in the juvenile justice system and those sorts of things. And these are really big and complex issues that I think law enforcement in itself did not cause in many instances, but certainly we have to take a look at what role, if any, we play in that, and I think do everything that we can, I think, to use our role to help engage our communities, to help unpeel the onion, so to speak, around what's that all about, how do these things happen, because I think, you know, in my community and in every community sitting around here, we know that most law enforcement outcomes end, you know, quite uneventfully. But at the same time, issues around trust and those sorts of things that we oftentimes hear and are all working on, I think in many cases, where people are drawn in by the big stuff, but it's the little things that I think ultimately really matter. And we have to look at that and try and make meaning of what that's all about. And that, frankly, is going to take the community to help us solve that. Those disparities that exist, or disproportionalities across race and arrest or detention, those facts are things that you know, the people sitting around this table can't just fix. We are going to need relationships and really tough conversations. And I know they're happening in many of our conversations. Mm-hmm. And that's going to need to continue and probably even be stepped up, I think, to really get over some of the relational challenges that exist.
Yes. You know, I think the thing that's changed, you know, this the most, and has been the most influential is the video cameras that everyone carries with them. It's the cell phones, and having the cameras and the video cameras readily available at any time. And as some of the others around this table have already captured, to see some of those instances, any use of force, even when appropriate, looks bad. I mean, it never looks good when you have to put your hands on another person. And there's emotion in that. And it's emotional for people to see some of the things they've seen. And I acknowledge that. There's you know, those aren't wins for anybody. So that's been a change, you know, a big game changer for this profession. Having said that, I think in a lot of ways it's been a good thing. I mean, there's an opportunity that lies there as well to make this a more transparent profession, to be more accountable to the citizens that we serve. You know, the chief from Columbia Heights here had stated, you know, I don't think anyone around this table currently doesn't have a body cam program. And, you know, that's increasing the accountability as well for all of us to not only have cameras on our dashboards and our squad cars, but to have cameras on our bodies as we're approaching individuals and interacting on calls. And I think those are all pieces that are going to get us a little closer to hopefully having better outcomes on a more regular basis. I acknowledge what's been said around here. One loss of life, even when justified, is too many. They're a tragedy for a community. But there are a lot of good acts that happen every single day that end very well also. So the conversation is good and it needs to continue. I think there's opportunity more than challenges. That's really what I see through this.
Yeah. To the Deputy Chief's point on the video cameras, we're a visually motivated and inspired, you know, that's what the way people are wired. That's why restaurants have photos next to their food. So we can show you videos all day long of law enforcement officers helping the lost kid or aiding a crash victim, and it's probably going to be fleeting or it would never even be shown or viewed. But those horrific videos that we've all seen, and if I ask you to think about that law enforcement, that negative law enforcement video, we all have one that pops in our head right away as the most egregious thing that we've seen. And tragically, that's what sticks. And I think that's where a lot of the perception comes from. We forget about those 385 million contacts, but we remember that one, and that's got to be representative of law enforcement because I saw it myself. And it is representative of that individual. It's not representative of that agency, of that team, and certainly not of American law enforcement.
Well, as we talk about this rhetoric and we look to get beyond the rhetoric, in the second hour, we're really going to dive into this idea of implicit bias. Does it exist? How does it manifest itself? And then secondly, what do we do to stave off cynicism and to fight this idea of implicit bias? And so my name is Andre Koen. You are watching Beyond the Rhetoric 2, Community Policing. We'll see you in just a bit.